That's my normal thing, too.
Welcome to our final debate of our 2012 Forsyth County Republican Party debate series. If you all would please take a seat. If I hadn't had the pleasure of meeting you, my name is Ethan Underwood. I have the honor of serving as chairman of the Forsyth County Republican Party. And we put on these debate series every 2 years to try to introduce you to candidates that are running for the Republican nomination. As always, we like to begin our meetings with the Republican Party with an invocation and a pledge of allegiance. So if you would, please stand as your opening. Father, we're grateful for your blessings for our country, for the rights that you've given to us. Help us to be good stewards of those rights. Give our community wisdom as we select our leaders. We pray that you give those who are running for office strength, courage to do the right things, to say the right things, and to act on their ways. Watch over us in all we do. Be with our public safety personnel. We pray that you especially protect our military and keep them safe. And we pray that you be with those who are struggling with financial problems and health problems. Forgive our sins. Use us as you will. In Christ's name.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This is exciting. We've still got folks trickling in. But we've got a packed night. We've got some good debates going on, and we certainly want to get into it. Mark, we appreciate you very much. I also want to thank Mr. Hamilton. He's responsible for the maps that are on the back of the wall. Several folks have said, well, since redistricting, I don't know which district I'm in. And it has been difficult to find. Most of us got an 8.5 by 11 map showing some of these new congressional districts, and even a magnifying glass doesn't tell you who your congressman is. So do take a look at these maps in the back, and we appreciate, again, Mr. Hamilton for getting those for us. Our first scheduled debate is at 7 o'clock. Do we have anybody here that's going to be offended if we go ahead and start the debate? All right, wonderful. If we could, we'll have our candidates come up who are running for State House Committee. Pleased to welcome with us Mr. Tom Knox to my left and also Mr. Geoff Duncan. Both are running for the new State House 26. This is a State House district that runs all the way from Windermere, wraps around the lake, and goes back into the Coal Mountain community. So they're going to be representing a good chunk of Forsyth County, whoever wins this race. And we have two great candidates, and we want to learn more about them. Rules for our debate series is that each candidate will be given 2 minutes to introduce himself, state why he's running for office, and what his goals are if he should win. During the next phase of the debate, we move to the questions. Each candidate will have 1 minute to answer a question, then the same question goes to his opponent. Then we come back to the original person we've asked, and then go back to the opponent. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond to each question, but the intent is to create a dialogue so that you can respond to each other's answers. However, we don't allow direct questions of candidates. We do have a time keeper, Mr. Joel Knapp, will be down the front. He'll let you know and give you a signal when there's 1 minute, 15 seconds, and when your time's up. And he's pretty vicious, so be mindful of the clock. We move to the final round of our debate. Each candidate will have a minute and a half to make their closing remarks. Our rules do state that no candidate is allowed to send or receive text messages during the debate. And we look forward to learning more about you both. If we can, we'll go ahead and start. Our first phase will be the 2 minute introductions. And we'll let Mr. Knox, would you like to make your introductory remarks?
Come on now. Good evening. Thank you all for being here. Appreciate your interest in this process. Would that we had a lot more folks here for it. My name is Tom Knox, and I've been honored to have been elected by the people of Forsyth County on 6 different occasions, 5 of those as the legislator and state representative representing Forsyth County, and once I carried the vote of Forsyth County as a candidate for the State Insurance Commissioner. I had been serving in the House for several years at that time, and I decided to leave the House because I was so concerned about Obamacare and the effect it was going to have on our state and the United States, and I was afraid that a lot of the folks weren't getting the idea that this was how dangerous this was. And so that's why I decided to leave the House and run for insurance commissioner. I'm proud to have been elected that many times, but I'm even more proud to have been supported all that time by my wife, Michelle, who's here, and some of my family members are here. My nephew and niece are here, Mark and Marlene Abkemeyer. They're residents of Forsyth County. Unfortunately, they don't live in the district. During my time in the House, I was one of the few people who actually ever passed legislation that reduced taxes, like taxes on premiums for health insurance, and passed legislation that made health savings accounts available to individuals and small businesses, just like they had for large corporations, and reduced the cost to those folks. I received the award from the National Federation of Independent Businesses for my work there. So I'm proud to be here. I'm proud to be a member of Lake Lanier Association, the National Rifle Association, Right to Life organization. I'm proud to have the, in particular, to have the endorsement of the Georgia Right to Life. I'm a member of the Georgia Republican Party, the Tea Party, and a member of this county, and I appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Well, good evening. I'd like to take a minute to thank the Forsyth County GOP for hosting the debate this evening. And I also can only imagine how exhausted Ethan and his team are after hosting almost two full weeks of debates. So thank you very much for your efforts. I'd also like to thank many of you in this room that have joined our Common Sense Conservative movement over the last 7 months and have helped us create an incredible amount of momentum by donating your time, your energy, and your hard-earned dollars. Last but not least, I want to thank my family for their support. My wife, Brooke, is the rock of our family, and the future of our three boys, Parker, Baylor, and Ryder, are the inspiration that keeps us both pushing forward through this campaign. In recent weeks, we've been honored to receive endorsements for our conservative campaign from the likes of the Forsyth County Tea Party and Georgia Right to Life. These endorsements are not just important for this campaign, they're important to the conservative voices right here in Forsyth County. Because if elected, we will work with these conservative groups and many others to not just move the legislative ball a few inches, but to move it miles. The time has come for us to not just elect conservatives that talk about being conservative, but we need to elect conservatives with the energy, commitment, and character to put their political careers on the line every single day down at the Capitol and move our conservative values forward. My job during this campaign is to not spend my time trying to convince you why you shouldn't vote for my opponent. My responsibility is to convince why I'm the right person to represent you, your family, and your business interests. As a happily married father of three school-age kids and a Forsyth County small business owner, I feel like I have the perspective necessary to represent each and every one of you down at the Capitol. My wife and I face the same challenges you do every single day. Geoff Duncan is ready to represent the 26th district in the State House with the eyes of a faith-based, principled conservative that has a successful track record as a small business owner here in the county. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, gentlemen. We'll be asking questions. These questions were developed by the executive committee, the unanimous consent of the executive committee for South GOP. And they run the gamut from social issues to economic issues to taxation. We want to know what you intend to do down to the gold belt. Our first question will be for Mr. Knox. Do you have 1 minute to respond? Mr. Knox, do you believe there should be legislation capping the value of gifts from lobbyists to state legislators?
I'm not opposed to that. I think it might be a good idea for us to have a cap on contributions or spending by lobbyists. I don't know how much they spend because I don't spend a whole lot of time going to dinner with folks. But I think the proposal is for a $100 cap right now. I don't see anything wrong with that.
Mr. Duncan, do you need me to repeat the question?
No, I've got the question. Absolutely, I support the $100 limit. I'm actually the only person in this campaign who signed the $100 lobbyist pledge. to get perspective on this issue before I signed this pledge. I went and actually met with a lobbyist down at the Capitol, and I wanted to get his perspective. We got a cup of coffee, and yes, I bought my own cup of coffee, because I wanted to understand what it looked like from their side. And it was amazing to me. His words were that an overwhelming amount of the lobbyists want the $100 limit, because what it enables them is to play on an even playing field. It enables them to be able to compete with their level of skill, with their information ability, because at the end of the day, a lobbyist's job is to not coerce or influence, it's to educate. Absolutely, I support the $100 cap limit.
Mr. Knox, anything additional about that?
I'd just point out that oftentimes lobbyists are attacked because they represent special interests. And I'd like to try to make you understand something. Everybody in this room is represented by any number of lobbyists. Whether it's the Cancer Society or it's the Small Business Association or it's the Boy Scouts, the school boards, whoever it is, all of those folks come to the legislature on your behalf and on behalf of other organizations that you belong to in order to ask the legislature to do or refrain from doing something that may help or hurt their interests. We all have those folks working for us, and Geoff's right. The main thing that they do is education. And let me just tell you what the main what they do that really helps, and that is we don't really have staffs at the house, so we actually use those folks as unpaid staff to help us get bills together. So they're a vital part of the whole process.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll give you some of my thought process how I got to the point of wanting the $100 cap limit. One of the companies I started has over 6,000 suppliers. And let's call those lobbyists. They're lobbying for my company's business each and every day. And for years, they call and they want to take our folks to dinner. They want to coerce them into buying their product. I don't feel like that's the best way to make decisions for my company's bottom line. I don't think that's the best way to make decisions for our clients. I'm going to be in my office at 6:30 in the morning. If you'd like to make an appointment, come in and see me, educate me, and in the evenings, my plan is to go home and spend time with my three kids and my wife.
Thank you. Next question will be Mr. Duncan. On this very evening, we are expecting a decision from the U.S. Supreme Court regarding Obamacare. If Obamacare is not found to be constitutional, I'm sorry, if it is found to be constitutional, how will you, as a member of the General Assembly, respond?
I think the first thing we must do, regardless of whether or not this legislature, the Supreme Court overturns this, is defeat Barack Obama in November. We've got to make sure that that happens. Look, the healthcare problem we've got is screaming cost. Tom spent time, many years working with the Insurance Commission. He knows this. The problems we have are our costs are screaming through the roof. We've got to manage healthcare costs. Some avenues to do that are through competition. We've got to create free markets in the insurance business so that we can compete. As a small business owner, every year I have to sign back up to renew our group plan with our company. I'm faced with the same three suppliers every year, and it's no mystery. Price goes up 10-15% every single year. I want to see competition enter the marketplace, and I also believe in tort reform. We don't need to be paying a premium because doctors are worried about frivolous lawsuits.
Mr. Knox, if Obamacare is found to be constitutional, how will you as a member of the General Assembly respond?
I'll do the same thing I was doing when I first found out that Obamacare was going to be the set piece of Mr. Obama's presidential election. I put my own efforts into one, passing legislation at the House, for instance, that would have kept our taxpayer dollars from going to Obamacare to pay for abortions through the Obamacare bill. That's a bill I authored and passed, and I've sponsored a number of bills like that. I also sponsored bills that, for instance, the health savings account bill that made insurance, health insurance available to small employers on a much less expensive basis and cut premium tax that was on those plans. So I'll continue to do those same things when I'm elected. I've already done it. I know how to do it. I'm going to do it again.
Mr. Duncan, would you like to add anything?
Well, yeah. During that period of time, my insurance costs have probably more than doubled. So I want to look to be even more aggressive. One of the concerns to me is one of the biggest lobbying efforts in the Capitol is probably from the insurance business. And that concerns me. Absolutely, it concerns me. We've got to roll up our sleeves and we got to go to work, and it can't be just through politicians. It's got to be through the free market system.
Mr. Knox, your finish.
With regard to the TARP reform, I was actually on the TARP reform committee at the request of the Speaker of the House at the time. When we passed TARP reform in Georgia, one of the biggest TARP reform bills that was passed in the United States at that time, and has had a very significant effect on lowering premiums for doctors for their malpractice insurance. Also on the cost side of this equation, it's convenient to blame insurance companies because they're the ones who always are out front. But the truth of the matter is most of the insurance that you see with the insurance company's name on is not insurance at all. It's simply that they're administering a plan for someone, an employer, or the government. Most of the money that's made by insurance companies in this country today is not from selling insurance policies, health insurance policies. It's mainly from running programs for people who don't have to buy insurance policies under federal law. Main cost of health care, the government.
Thank you, Jim. This next question will be led off by Mr. Knox. Why are you the best candidate to serve in this office?
I have experience doing what everybody else is talking about doing. I've heard folks talking about we'll do this, we can do that, we should do this. I've actually done it over and over and over again. I've helped reduce the size of the government by hundreds of millions of dollars. I've voted for balanced budgets a dozen times and more while I was in the House. And I've been applauded for my work on illegal immigration, on my work on the toughest sex offender bill in the state, in the United States. I've been recognized by the Georgia Chamber of Commerce for my work on behalf of business and making Georgia a business-friendly state. Business-friendly makes jobs.
Mr. Duncan, why are you the best candidate to serve in this office?
I think there's two main reasons. One is I've got the energy necessary to move the ball forward, to not just go down to the Capitol and talk about being conservative or to play the part. I want to be part of the solution. That's important to me. It's important that we start to move the ball forward. We talk about experience, and that's probably going to be a topic that comes up here. We've got personal experience. We've got professional experience. I've got perspective. I live the life every one of you live. I've got three kids in public schools. I run a business. I face the same struggles. When the economy turned down, it was time for me to learn how to cut the budgets, to manage our business, to help my employees continue to realize the American dream.
Mr. Jones, would you like to add anything?
Thank you.
Mr. Duncan, would you like to take any additional help? This next question, Mr. Duncan. Given that same-sex marriage is prohibited by the Georgia Constitution, would you support a law recognizing same-sex civil unions?
At this time, actually, unequivocally, my answer is no. I don't believe in same-sex marriages or civil unions. That is a personal belief of mine. I'm a very faith-based man, and our family is too. And we don't believe in civil unions or would not recognize civil unions or gay marriage.
Mr. Knox, do you need to repeat the question?
No, I got it. As a Christian, a committed Christian, I believe that marriage is a union of a man and a woman. But I don't believe it's because the government says that's what the case is. I believe it's because that's what our belief is, and that's our commitment to ourselves, that's what we think marriage is. We've thought that forever. Now then, on the other hand, what does the government have to do with deciding why are they involved in the marriage business at all? It's bucks. And you want to know what the bucks are about? The bucks are about when you go to the courthouse and you say, I'm marrying Susie. What they want to know is, they want to be able to find you if you decide that you're not going to support your children. They want to know where to look for you, and they want to know who you are, and they want to make you pay up for those children. That's the only interest, and it's really the only interest they should have, in who's married to who. Again, I oppose same-sex marriages. That's not a marriage.
Mr. Duncan, do I get it?
Yeah, marriage is very, very important to me. I think it's one of the cornerstone building blocks to our society, and I will restate my position. I would not support same-sex civil unions.
Not the next question, Mr. Knox, will lead off. Is that right?
Yes.
Mr. Knox, how do you propose to improve the state's education system?
Well, I think one of the best things we can do is go to school choice. We've already started, we have one of the premier programs in our charter schools in the state of Georgia. Most of them are working pretty well. We also have a very active homeschool community in the state of Georgia and in Forsyth County. And I'm very impressed with the results that we get from homeschooled children. They exceed the performance of children in our county schools. And we've got some great schools in this county. We have excellent schools, amongst the best in the state of Georgia. And the other thing is school choice. I'd like to see us go to a voucher program. There's a lot of opposition to that, but let me ask you this. What's wrong with the person who's buying the product having the money to decide who they're going to buy the product from? Because that's what it's all about. Education's a product, and we should give them the money to go buy it.
Mr. Duncan, how do you propose the state's education system?
Absolutely, I support the voucher program and charter schools. We are fortunate to have one of the best education systems in the state here in Forsyth County. One of the first spots I went to go visit after I announced my campaign was to go see Dr. Evans, our school superintendent. I've got three boys that are going to come through this public education system. I wanted to get his perspective. I wanted to get his take. I wanted to see what we could do in this state, because here's the challenge we've got. We cannot continue to just compare ourselves against other students and other school districts in the state. Our kids will graduate from high school and from college and compete in a global economy. It's going to require bigger and brighter education systems. One of the things we do well in Forsyth County that we hope to take statewide, and Dr. Evans, I think, has the drive and also the attention of folks, is to improve technology in our school systems. It's to allow kids to understand what that technology can do for them in the workplace. My sister's a school teacher in the county, and a lot of these questions, I spend time bouncing them off her.
Mr. Knox, would you like to add anything?
Thank you.
Mr. Duncan, any additional questions? Mr. Duncan, what will you do to prevent illegal immigration in Georgia?
Obviously, a very important topic after the Supreme Court ruling. I've got three main issues that need to be addressed for immigration. First and foremost, we need to protect our borders as a country. Our country is failing us by not protecting our borders. Right now, we're talking about millions of illegal aliens entering the country from Mexico. What if that problem was hundreds or thousands of radical Al-Qaeda members? We need to take protecting our borders serious. It's not a matter of economy. It's not a matter of social issues. It's a matter of national security. The other area I'd like to do is streamline the visa process. I didn't say simplify. I didn't say make it easier to get in here. I want to streamline the visa process so that there's an ability for hardworking individuals who want to be a part of this country and to pay their taxes and to pay their portion and to participate in society. We need to streamline that visa process. And lastly, we need to change our mentalities. We need to change the way we view illegal immigration. It's not fair that thousands, hundreds of thousands of our jobs are going away to illegal aliens.
Mr. Norris?
I've already done something about illegal immigration. I was one of the folks who supported and voted for the immigration bill that passed in the state of Georgia. And when we saw the decision from the Supreme Court recently against Arizona, all of us in Georgia said, good. We're glad we looked at what they were doing, and we did it a little bit better. I don't think they're going to be able to break our law like they did Arizona's. We need to continue to do that. One of the things that, you know, makes some sense to me on the whole immigration is, number one, close the border. We've got to do that. If we can just convince the legislators to do that, we'll have won a real victory. But the second thing is we need to go back to the way we used to do it before Ted Kennedy ran this new current immigration system down our throat. Most people have forgotten about that. He was the author of the current immigration system. Before that, we used to have a lottery system for letting people into the country. And we would, you know, do the thing, you pull out the paper and say, okay, if you're from Turkey or wherever, come on, you know, because you got the lucky. We don't do that anymore. Now we go around with percentages for different groups to let them in. Hopes. You got to quit doing that. Let's not fly on Ted Kennedy's cooktails.
I've never heard of the lottery system for immigration. I'm for a process that allows hardworking people who want to adopt the ideals of the American dream and enter our country under the premise they want to work hard. It's the Republican model, right? We want to work hard. We want to be self-sufficient. We don't need individuals to enter this country to just ride on the coattails of all of us hard-paying taxpayers.
Mr. Duncan, why are you a Republican, and with which Republican principles do you most identify?
It's Tom's question, but I'd like to go first, since you asked.
Or no?
I think he's gotten three firsts now.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
You're right. Mr. Duncan, I apologize.
All right. Well, I'm a Republican in part because of my dad. He had me voting for Eisenhower in 1950, not voting, but working for Eisenhower in 1952. I know I look old, but I'm not that old. I became enamored of the Republican Party when I realized that they were the party of capitalism, of free enterprise, of less government, lower taxes. And I decided I had to get in and work in order to be able to make sure those things happen, because I know, after being around for a while, that the real genius of our system is the free enterprise system. And you know, the only reason that these other countries have these welfare systems where they have free everything is because the United States funded them. We're the only country that had capital farm that they could use to be able to keep those systems going. This is the right way to go. That's why I'm a Republican.
Mr. Duncan?
I'm a Republican because it's woven into my very fiber. It's neat to look out at my mom and dad standing out or sitting out in the audience. I remember as a little kid understanding what the principles in our house were, the Republican principles. We used to sit around and watch Ronald Reagan in the Oval Office give a presidential address, even so much as to where I wrote a letter to Ronald Reagan, and guess what, he wrote me back. My mom still has the letter. I'm a Republican because I've been raised to be self-reliant, to be fiscally responsible, to learn the value of working hard, and to be socially conservative. The great part is my wife and I get to pass these ideals on to our three boys. Being a Republican is not a lifestyle, it's not a position, it's not a box I check. It's my very fiber.
Mr. Knox, anything additional?
I'm also a Republican, and to the extent that I served as chairman of the South County Republican Party, and I was pleased and served in various capacities for the South County Republican Party, and I spent a lot of money on Republican Party causes and Republican candidates over the years because I believed in the Republican Party. And I was also honored to receive the Ronald Reagan Award from the Forsyth County Republican Party during my tenure with them.
Tom just brought up the name Ronald Reagan. Obviously, all of us talk quite a lot about Ronald Reagan. The part that intrigued me to Ronald Reagan was not by what he said. It was by what he did. He rolled his sleeves up, and he led the pack. That's what we need to move this country. We talk about fixing the problems we have by moving inches. The solutions to our problems are way out in the distance, and we need to find people, not just in this election, but in elections all over this country, and put people with bold leadership skills that have the ability to put their political careers on the line every day and go do the heavy lifting.
Mr. Duncan, you asked how we're getting through these weeks, apparently the way we're starting to show up. So I apologize for getting a little bit out of order, but I believe this is your question. What will you do to improve your legislative district's water supply?
Yeah, another hot topic. We've had two court cases here. It still shocks me to think we had to wait for a court to tell us that we're allowed to consider Lake Lanier as a drinking source for our community. We have got to take, Lake Lanier is not just a recreation center for us, it's way more than that. We've got thousands of business owners that their livelihoods depend on that lake. We've got thousands, tens of thousands of homeowners that property values are dependent on that lake. We have millions of people who depend on the drinking water. The part that catches me off guard is that how we let the intensity of the conversation about our water problems ebb and flow with the levels of the lake. When the lake's low, everybody seems to be really worried about it. The capital's a buzz, right? Lake comes back up, let's move on to the next issue. I want to put my foot on the gas pedal, and I don't want to take it off until somebody tells me who the person is in charge of Buford Dam, the water flows that go out. It's going to be hard for me to look at a constituent in the eye and say that a muscle 1,000 miles or 500 miles downstream is more important than their business.
Mr. Nutt?
Yeah, just coincidentally, I happened to be with Governor Deal last night when he was talking about the decision sort of knocked Alabama back out of the three-way lawsuit that's been going on over the water of the Chattahoochee River. And I'm applauding him and the legislature for bringing a plan forward to create reservoirs other than Lake Lanier around the state of Georgia. One of our problems in Georgia is that all the water that we get, it runs off real fast. The water of the Chattahoochee River starts just about 45 miles north of Forsyth County, and a little stream about like that. And that's the main source of the water in Lake Lanier. So we've got to find sources other than Lake Lanier and other than the Chattahoochee River to continue to be able to supply the water needs of the state. And I think one of those is for alternate sources like reservoirs.
Mr. Duncan, anything additional?
Yeah, I was the only candidate who went to the Lake Lanier Association annual meeting this year, and also the only one to submit written responses to their three questions. Tom is a member of the Lake Lanier Association. The topic of conversation for us was to talk about the reservoir technique of going from 1071 to 1073. We essentially want to add 2 feet on the level of the lake. Estimates have hit my desk that said if we want to build a new reservoir somewhere else, it's going to be 20 years because of all the government oversight, all the different folks involved, all the bureaucrats involved in that process. We can build, for pennies on the dollar, 2 more feet on top, what would essentially be the largest proposed reservoir on top of Lake Lanier if we just get the Corps and some other government agencies to allow us to go from 1071 to 1073. That's a common sense solution. Costs less, and it's quicker. We can get it done quicker.
I agree with that, and I'd like to see us do that. And we've been trying to get the federal government to do just that since I've been a member of the Lake Lanier Association for about 25 years, and we've not been successful. Senator Murphy and I and some other members of the delegation went to Washington, D.C. and as a group to try to get our legislators to do something about the bill. And it's just not that easy. So I don't think we ought to put a whole lot of eggs in that basket. We've been putting them there, and it hasn't resulted in any chickens. So what we're looking for is something where we're actually going to get some results from and that we don't have to rely on the federal government. We need to do it here in Georgia.
Mr. Knox, this question's for you. Do you consider yourself to be pro-life or pro-choice, and do you believe there are any situations when abortion is justified?
I am pro-life, and I have said that I do not agree with abortion under any circumstances.
Mr. Duncan, do you need to repeat the question?
No, I've got it. Thank you, Ethan. This week was a very humbling week for my wife and I. We received the endorsement from Georgia Right to Life, and for full disclosure, Tom also is endorsed by Georgia Right to Life. It's good to know that our district will be represented regardless by somebody who cares for the unborn. Under no circumstances do I believe in abortion. Let me give you a little bit of insight. I had to go into my interview, and this is a tough topic. This is very, very tough. I wanted to sit in the room, and I just answered the questions, and I told them, they're actually here this evening. I said, I'm gonna answer this as though my Lord is standing right next to me. And as hard as these questions are, I feel like there can be good made out of any situation.
Mr. Knox, back to
Patrick. I don't have anything further.
Mr. Duncan.
Georgia uses multiple taxes to fund its budget, including sales tax, income taxes, and property taxes. Among these three forms of taxes, what do you think is the proper proportion each one should bear?
Let me first lay the groundwork before I get to the answer. We don't have a tax problem in this state. We have a spending problem in this state, which then has created a tax problem. We need to cut spending before we start the conversation of even thinking about raising or lowering taxes, raising taxes. We've got to go into, Mark Hamilton mentioned it earlier, zero-based budgeting. It amazes me that we're 5 years into the worst financial crisis we've ever had, and we're just finally introducing zero-based budgeting. If these people were running a small business, they would have had to done it years ago, or they'd be out of business.
Mr. Knox?
Yeah, I think, you know, if a business operator like the federal government, for instance, they'd be in jail. Matter of fact, they'd put people in jail for doing just exactly what they're doing. That's sort of some chutzpah, you know? You know, it makes you wonder what our government is really all about. Let me say this, as far as the proportion of the taxes, I think the proportion's all wrong. I think it should be 100% sales tax, and there's a good reason for it. I support the fair tax. It's a great idea. It's been well researched, and it's been argued, very well argued. And none of the folks that can do something about it want to talk about it. That tells you that's something that really needs to happen. Now, what's the best thing about the sales tax? It's a consumption-based tax. And we have some control over that because we can decide if we're going to buy a lot of things and whether we want to pay those taxes or not. So it's self-limiting. And guess what else? They can't raise the sales tax unless they tell us they're going to raise it and how much they're going to raise it by. And they don't get to go directly into our pocket for it. And we're already doing sales tax collections anyhow, so it doesn't require us to do anything different.
Mr. Duncan, I'll take a little liberty and push this a little harder. There's got to be some type of taxes. Money's got to be raised somehow. So I'll restate the question as far as sales tax, income, and property taxes. Where do you think the emphasis ought to be placed on?
What was the middle one, sales?
Sales tax, income taxes, and property taxes.
Yeah, we talk about a usage tax, a fair tax. We've got to migrate a system that gets us there. Property taxes are... make no sense. I still don't understand how the math works. It's like they figure out what number they need to raise and then they justify it through the property tax. Income taxes, we all look at our paychecks at the end of every 2 weeks and we look down and it just amazes us where all this money's going and you never get to touch it. Sales tax, I've got issues with certain types of sales tax, and I don't know if we'll get to the question, but T-SPLOS. Let's use T-SPLOS as an example. We can continue to 1% ourselves until we've got nothing left. We've got to create a system that allows individuals who want to go out and make purchases to be taxed. We've got to figure out what that is. I agree with Tom, there's some sort of piece that's in there, but we open ourselves up to the T-SPLOS game, which we're essentially going to take tens of millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars, put it in an envelope and send it to a P.O. box downtown and allow bureaucrats to figure out how they're going to spend our money.
Mr. Knox?
I passed legislation in my second term, I guess it was, to freeze property tax valuations on property taxes in Forsyth County. That's still in effect today on the county side of the tax. So I know a little bit about what I'm talking about. I've also passed or worked on legislation to just number the taxes. You know, that instead of having the taxes, the puppy dog tax, or you know, the school tax, or this tax, or next tax, there's only one tax. Called TA tax, that's it. And they're all the same. So, you know, if we ever had a bill that required us to number all the taxes that we have, you would be astounded at how many taxes you're paying.
Mr. Knox, how will you work to prevent the federal government from encroaching upon the power of the states?
Well, I think the first thing we can do is start trying to amend the Constitution by repealing the 16th and the 17th Amendments to the Constitution, one of which allowed the federal government to go directly to the individual citizen in every state and take money from them and call it an income tax. The second one is to repeal the 17th Amendment that allowed contrary to the original construction of the Constitution, it allowed for direct election of U.S. senators. I don't have enough time to explain why that wasn't a good idea, but the crux of it is this. What happened is, between elections, for 6 years, nobody can go to those U.S. senators and say, don't vote for Obama here. Now, the way it was, when the states appointed, or the House, or the legislature appointed senators, they kept track of what they were doing. And the governor of the legislature went and said, don't do this, son, because we're not going to forget about it, because we're watching it all the time, because we're down here having to put up with your nonsense every year. When the election rolls around again, you're not going to be back here to do this. So don't do it.
Yeah, repealing the 16th and 17th Amendment, obviously Tom was talking about it. And it was good to see that your congressional candidates in the debate yesterday, I believe I read that they were both in support of repealing the 17th Amendment. But as a small business owner, I've learned to prioritize. And I'm being elected, looking to be elected for a 2-year term. I want to look for the path of least resistance to change this company, this country immediately, and that's to find ways to change who's in our White House. We've got to get Obama out. We've got to get jobs created in this county, in this district. We talk about all the problems. Guys, there's over 10% of you in this county are unemployed right now. That is a dangerous position to be in, and now we're looking at our fifth year of high unemployment, low property values. We've got to make change now. We've got to get bold leadership in the state and at the federal level. And I want to start with getting Obama out of the White House.
I said the 16th and 17th, I meant both of them, because the 16th is income tax. And buddy, if you've got the power to tax, you've got the power to destroy. And that's basically what's been happening to the constitutional republic of ours.
I want to lead by example. So I'm bold enough to think if we can get some sort of fair tax, usage tax here in Georgia, we can get other states to jump on. And what Tom's talking about is we're going to repeal income tax. We've got to support the government somehow, some way. We need to cut spending, but we need to get a national fair tax plan in place. And I'm bold enough to think we can lead the path.
Gentlemen, stay our last question as well. Should the state assist in funding a new stadium for the NFL?
Absolutely not. Not sure if anyone in this room knows, but I'm a former professional athlete, so most folks would probably think I would be all for a stadium, and the answer is absolutely not. We need government to do the government's job, and we need private markets to do what private markets do. There's absolutely no reason why we should take, especially in the middle of one of the first worst financial crises we've ever had, we should take our public hard-earned dollars and apply it to a stadium, which from what I've read is just to get one Super Bowl into the city of Atlanta. My answer is unequivocally no to supporting a new stadium.
Mr. Duncan?
I oppose that. In general, I'm not in favor of these so-called government initiatives to create business and create jobs and so on. Most of the time, that's not what's happening at all. The best way that you can get to bring industry in to support the kind of infrastructure that you want, including facilities for sports teams, is to have a well-run government, have a low tax base, and have a business-friendly government and economy in your state. Folks will come there. If you build it, they will come. By the way, as far as my athletic prowess, I should mention that I also was on the championship church league softball team.
What are you doing next Wednesday?
Well, in that vein, I will also wish luck to tonight is the championship game for the Forsyth County Old Guy Lacrosse League. They're playing at Bennett Park right now, so good luck to those guys out there on the field. At this point, we will have our closing statements. Mr. Duncan, 1.5 minutes.
Once again, I'd like to thank the Forsyth County GOP for hosting the debate this evening, and I also want to thank all of you for coming out. My hope here tonight is to show everyone that I'm not in this to just play the part. I'm in this to make a difference. Not the kind of difference that's captured in a 10-second soundbite or summarized in a 1-paragraph email, but the kind of difference that creates a movement that gets us back to putting our kids' generation in front of our generation, a movement that requires leaders to be leaders with energy, commitment, and character, a movement that expects those same very leaders to put their political careers on the line every single day and better represent the very people that voted them into office. Several lines of distinction were drawn between my opponent and myself this evening. These lines of distinction aren't necessarily about our positions. They seem to be more about our passions. My passion is to not just play the part of a State House member, it's to stand up and make a difference as a State House member. I'm not just a candidate in this election cycle, I'm also a voter. And I'm looking to vote for individuals that have the vision and energy to not just bring us back to where we were at a few short years ago, but to take us to places we can only imagine. This has been an incredible experience for my family and I to see firsthand the momentum that has been building over the last several months for our common sense conservative movement. With only 1 month to go, we're thankful to the hundreds and hundreds of people so far that have signed up to make phone calls, hand out information, and to even go door to door on our behalf. I humbly ask each and every person in this room for your vote and your prayers. God bless you.
Thank you all for attending and for listening to us talk about what we want to talk about and talk about what we've done. I mentioned that I received was on the Honorable Georgia Chamber of Commerce for our leadership and job creation in this state, and that's because I actually helped pass legislation that did just exactly that. I think that probably the most important thing we need to do in this election cycle is make sure that we don't have another Obama anyplace. You know why? Because experience does count. A lot of folks thought, oh, well, you know, Obama, he had a couple of years here and he did that, you know, so. But the truth of the matter was, he was absolutely, totally, and completely unprepared to be president of the United States. He hadn't done anything. He talked about it, but he hadn't done anything. The difference is, when you've done things, you've learned, you've gained experience, and you know how to get the job done. That's me, and that's why I'm asking for your vote, because it's so important that we get it done, and we get it done fast.
Thank you, Joe. We're going to take a 15-minute break, and we'll start back at 7:45.
Well done.
We want to make an issue, neutral, candidate.